What do we owe the honor? No? I just got a small coffee. I'm just gonna not reply on that one.
How are you?
It's a good evening. Good day.
It's really nice out right now.
It is.
Not bad.
This morning it was cold.
True. 18 when I went out.
18 when I went to work.
Yes,
I did. Spills my coffee.
Yes.
Looks like another almost full house again tonight.
I'm sure they're not all here.
Okay, I've got another one right now. See a press conference. It's been so long. I don't know. And I remember. I remember writing the entire ordinance, doing all the research, comparing all the communities. You know,
My brother-in-law is at the
dinner. He says, well, it's not
because all these articles that you've read still open. I'm like, oh, well, how do you shut them? He said, well, you can. I didn't know.
That stuff way beyond my technical ability.
Yeah.
That's okay.
What's that?
That's okay. When the power goes off, I'll break out the slide rule.
Yeah, exactly. Now I can still figure concrete.
For hat rack, I didn't see a hat rack.
Yeah, when I started out, you used to have to convert everything to decimal.
Yeah.
Go back to inches. Out of choice. Invention was the construction master calculator.
Did you have a good Thanksgiving? What did you?
Yeah. 18.
Wow. And who did the cooking?
Not us.
I'm just following the one here on the computer. But the wall clocks are all different.
They're equally off. One's fast and one's slow, about 2 minutes.
Well, it's just the best time to be in the valley.
Mm-hmm. Usually, you'd have to share. My brother and I share.
We're going to call to order the December 1st, 2015 meeting of the Planning and Zoning Commission. And please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. Annie, would you like to lead us?
I to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I think we'll go a little out of order here, and we'll take a roll call next.
Annie Lane.
Here.
Florence Sloan.
Here.
Michael Bacon.
Here.
Gary Passiak.
Here.
Claude Baker.
Here.
Charles Merritt.
Here.
Gwen Roach.
Here. Item number 3A is minutes. Consideration and possible action to approve the November 3rd, 2015 regular meeting minutes. Do you have any comments? Seeing none, the chair will entertain a motion.
I'll make the motion.
I'll second it.
We have a motion and a second to approve the minutes of November 3rd, 2015. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. Item 5, staff report. Do we have a staff report this evening?
We have no staff report this evening.
Thank you. Item 6 is a public hearing. Consideration and possible action to hold a public hearing on proposed amendments to the text of the Unified Development Ordinance, UDO, regarding adopting additional limitations on medical marijuana land uses in the town of Chino Valley, including medical marijuana dispensaries, off-site cultivation facilities, and infusion facilities to provide citizens with another opportunity to provide comments regarding the proposed amendments.
Do you want to say something?
No, you go ahead. If you would like to do the staff report first.
Did you want to say something about public comment first? The 3 minutes?
Oh, when we get to the okay. Hearing, I'll say that, yeah.
Good evening, commissioners. Before you, we are revisiting the medical marijuana regulation of manner and placement in the town of Chino Valley. Can we go to that PowerPoint? Thank you. Just to review for those who have not been here before. Oh, I can click. I keep forgetting I can click. I want to review the actions already taken by the town of Chino Valley in regards to the manner and placement of medical marijuana facilities in the town. The Proposition 203 was approved by the voters of the state of Arizona in November of 2010. In April of 2011, there was a public hearing at the Planning and Zoning Commission to make a recommendation to town council regarding regulation of manner and placement. On 5/11, the town council referred the matter back to staff, requesting that they include a 500-foot separation between churches and any medical marijuana use. At the March of 2012 meeting, the Planning and Zoning held an additional public hearing and recommended council not include a separation between any churches and medical marijuana uses. In April of 2012, the town council decided that rather than impose additional regulation, they would abide solely by the state regulations at that time and still are 500 feet from a school, public or private. On 9/10/13, town council directed staff to research and draft medical marijuana regulations. On 11/19/13, the Planning and Zoning Commission held a public hearing and forwarded amendments to town council with recommendations for approval. On 12/10/13, the town council adopted ordinance 13779 regulating the manner and placement of medical marijuana uses within the town of Chino Valley. On March of 2014, town council adopted resolution 14/10/25 opposing the legalization of recreational marijuana. And in April of that year, also adopted resolution 14/10/30, supporting a tax on medical marijuana growing facilities. For round two, we have discussed the proposed changes and took public comment at an October 27, 2015 town council meeting, conducted citizen review, and held a public at the Planning and Zoning Commission on November 3rd, 2015, a public hearing on November 17th. We're here again this evening on December 1st. Depending upon the commission's decision, we will be possibly recommending action to the town council on January 12th, 2015, and the town council will be holding a study session on December 10th of 2015. So these are all of the times that the town council and/or the planning and zoning commission have taken up this issue governing the use of, or the location of medical marijuana in the town of Chino Valley. We've had a lot of discussion over the last month and a half to 2 months regarding the use of medical marijuana. This is a very emotional an issue. People have very strongly held beliefs regarding whether or not marijuana should be considered medical, whether it should be used for medicinal purposes. What we're here to focus on this evening is the regulation of the manner and placement of uses. There are a lot of things that, while they are important, we cannot base regulations on opinion and emotion. We have to focus on the facts at hand, and I want to steer the conversation this meeting back to what the facts are regarding medical marijuana in the state of Arizona. First of all, as to the use of medical marijuana in Arizona, again, the voters of the state of Arizona approved Proposition 203, 50.1 to 49.9 in 2010. Arizona Revised Statutes Title 36 set forth the regulation framework of medical marijuana in the state of Arizona, and subsection 2803 directs the Arizona Department of Health Services to adopt rules further regulating medical marijuana in Arizona. The fact of the matter is that medical marijuana is a legal use in the state of Arizona. As to the regulation of manner and placement in Chino Valley, again, the town council has had numerous meetings and public hearings that's been before planning and zoning. The town council sitting in 2010 discussed amendments to the UDO and declined to amend it, deciding instead to impose the state's loan separation requirement of 500 feet from public or private schools. In 2013, the town council again directed staff to research and make recommendations to council regarding the manner and placement of medical marijuana uses. After notification in accordance with ARS 9-46204, town council adopted ordinance 13-779, setting forth regulations for the manner and placement of medical marijuana uses in the town. We have been through this process once already. We have set forth rules and regulations. We are now being asked to come back and look at these again. The facts involving regulation of marijuana by the federal government. The possession and use of marijuana in the United States has been illegal since 1937. Marijuana was classified as a Schedule I drug sometime in the 70s. The Department of Justice is precluded by the 2014 Appropriations Bill from using funds to enforce federal laws regarding marijuana in states that have legalized it. There is a rider in the Appropriations Bill that forbids DEA from using money to go after people who are legally growing it in states where it is legal, medically or recreationally. There was a case in the last 3 months, the DOJ case, where the federal courts have upheld that requirement. The U.S. Attorney General's office has reprioritized enforcement, and they've decided to focus their efforts on keeping it out of the hands of minors, stopping resulting cash flow to gangs and cartels, among other things that they have on their list, and not focusing their enforcement activities on those states where medical marijuana has been legalized. So the DEA themselves are limited in their ability to prosecute in states where medical marijuana is legal. If you are following the laws of that state, the DOJ cannot come in and prosecute you. Whether we like it or not, the following are facts. Nonconforming use is defined in the UDO in Chapter 2, Definition, Subsection 2.1, Meaning of Words and Terms, as follows. A structure or land which was lawfully established and maintained prior to the adoption of this ordinance, or any amendment thereto, or annexation to the town which does not conform to the use regulations for the district in which it is located. A text amendment to the UDO can therefore change the legal status of a structure or property from a legal conforming use to a legal non-conforming use. Chapter 4, General Regulations, Expansion of a Non-Conforming Use states that no non-conforming building, use of building, or use of the land shall be expanded in any way that enlarges it or reinforces the nonconformity. So should the recommendation go to town council and be adopted that we somehow further regulate or create a nonconforming use, those people who are in a legal nonconforming status cannot expand their use. As to the Private Property Rights Protection Act, Proposition 207 from 2006, Arizona Revised Statute Title 12, Courts and Civil Proceedings, sets forth the regulations for protections under this act. The act requires just compensation for the diminution of value resulting from enactment or applicability of any land use law after the date the property was transferred to the owner. Property owners have a statutory ability and right to relief when their property values are diminished by a land use action taken by the town after they've acquired real property. So an owner who has purchased this property, started developing it for a purpose, and then the town takes an action that reduces that ability, it creates exposure for us in terms of Proposition 207. So to summarize, the following are facts. Medical marijuana is a legal use in Arizona. ARS 9462.01 enables the town to regulate land uses within the corporate boundary of the town, which we have done. And the Proposition 207, ARS 36, requires relief to property owners whose property values have been diminished by land use laws adopted after they have acquired real property. So why are we focusing on this, on this conversation right now? There are a number of people who strongly object to marijuana in any form, which I understand. However, we also have to look at private property rights and any exposure we may have there. It's not as simple as just banning this use in the town. We can't do that. We can regulate it, but we cannot ban it. So when we talk about policy, this is how the regulation of public policy regulation really works. The feds regulate interstate commerce. They regulate drugs and drug use through the FDA, and they enforce federal law. The town doesn't enforce federal law if this is still illegal if the DEA or the FDA has decided that this is still an illegal drug. I can't go out, or the town cannot go out and do any enforcement based on a federal regulation. That's not our purview to regulate. Similarly, the state policy regulates intrastate commerce, stuff that goes on from county to county within the state, and enforcement of state law. Both the Private Property Protection Act and the legalization of marijuana are the result of voter mandates or initiatives where the voters of the state of Arizona decide what laws they want. Local policy, what the town can regulate, is the manner and placement of land uses legal in the state of Arizona. That's it. This is what we can regulate. We've heard a number of objections from members of the community to marijuana and the potential impacts. We've heard several times that high school kids are getting pot from young adults that have medical marijuana cards or other people with cards, and they're selling it on the side. This is an enforcement issue. This is something that should be reported to the police and to the Arizona Department of Health Services. Outside of the police, we have no enforcement ability to go after anyone that is distributing marijuana illegally. It's a violation of federal law. Again, this is a federal enforcement issue. While it is still a class one drug or a schedule one drug, the feds have chosen to limit their enforcement of their laws. If you have issues with the feds not enforcing their laws, you need to contact Congressman Gosar, Senator Flake, or Senator McCain, or the Drug Enforcement Agency. Those are the people that regulate federal law. We cannot regulate based on the fact that this is a violation of federal law. We've heard several times that the county didn't vote for this. It was approved by the voters of Maricopa County. Because the majority of voters in Yavapai County did not support it, we should not have to have it here. And we should not have to abide by it. The Arizona Medical Marijuana Act was approved as a statewide initiative. Yavapai County and its political subdivisions cannot exempt themselves from state law simply because they didn't vote for it or they don't like it. It's a statewide initiative. The voters have approved it. We have to deal with the fallout. We've also heard that there's no evidence that it has any effectiveness medically. Again, that's something that the FDA determines, whether or not it's medically effective. The town does not regulate uses based on whether the FDA decides that those are effective uses or not. The proposed options. So we've gone back through all of the meetings and the minutes and called out all of the proposed modifications to the UDO that we've discussed previously. Number one was to allow cultivation facilities on-site only, which means they would have to be attached to a dispensary. Right now, the current Arizona Department of Health Services regulations restrict distribution of dispensaries to one dispensary per community health assessment area. The town already has one dispensary. Unless the Department of Health Services changes its regulations, no additional cultivation facilities would be allowed in town because they would have to be attached to another dispensary. Two, remove cultivation and infusion facilities from conditional uses in AR36, AR5, and AR4 zoning districts. Larger parcels of land near electrical utilities usually have those zoning. Just because they're AR4 and AR5 doesn't mean that's the only size that they're limited to those size. Lots of 4 or 5 acres, that's the minimum. Medical marijuana uses are conditional uses in these zoning districts. Conditional use permits require the same public hearing process as any zoning change. So currently, if you wanted to do a cultivation facility in one of these zoning districts, you would have to come forward and go through the same approval process as somebody requesting rezoning. Number three, remove cultivation, infusion, and dispensary facilities for permitted uses in commercial light, commercial heavy, and industrial zoning districts require a conditional use permit. Permitted uses undergo no additional public review, only building and site plan review for construction and engineering purposes. Allowing these uses with the issuance of conditional use, again, would require additional public hearings and review identical to a rezoning. Require a conditional use permit for any medical marijuana facility in industrial districts only. We've broken this down to industrial districts only, industrial and commercial heavy, industrial, commercial heavy, and commercial light. Again, the same result would happen is that they would be here, they would be limited just to industrial districts and they would have to obtain a conditional use permit. Here we would allow them, it's option B would be commercial heavy and industrial, and option C would be commercial light, commercial heavy and industrial. Require 500 foot separation from churches in addition to the already specified uses that would further restrict land available for development as a cultivation site. Practically speaking, most churches are located in close proximity to residential zoning districts, so the impact of this would probably be minimal. The statutory separation for liquor licenses is 300 horizontal feet from churches and K-12 schools. Measure separation from property line to property line and exclude public way, right-of-way from measurement of separation. If council decides to eliminate medical marijuana uses from AR zoning, the language can be truncated, and excluding public rights-of-way will further increase separation anywhere from 25 to 200 feet. Option number seven is to limit the size of cultivation facilities to 3,000 square feet or another specific size limit. This example here is the Bonnie Plant Farm on 2 North, on East 2 North. Each one of those greenhouses is approximately 12,000 square feet. The smaller blue box you see is an approximately 3,000 square foot area. Staff recommends forwarding all seven options, including 3A, B, and C, for consideration and possible action by town council. This will afford council an opportunity to review all options at the study session on December 10th of 2015 and hold an additional public hearing at the regular meeting scheduled for January 12th, 2016. I'd be happy to entertain any questions anyone has.
Questions on the commission? Yes, Gary?
Yes, sir.
Can you hear me? Last couple of meetings, we've had conditional use changed over to hard zoning because people were coming in saying they can't get financing
Correct.
On conditional use.
Mm-hmm.
One of them was on 4 North, I think,
yes.
next to Lucy's.
Mm-hmm.
Why are we now recommending conditional use?
Because it gives us an additional regulatory, an additional level of regulation that we wouldn't have with hard zoning. If they can't get financed, they're asking to expand their use, as opposed to someone who has property they can't do anything with because of the conditional use.
Would that apply only to the marijuana growing facilities if we did that? In other words, Gary is saying we're going backwards by putting conditional use permits back into the equation, which we've removed several here recently.
Mm-hmm.
If we leave the conditional use permit option in, is it only for the marijuana growing facilities and not related to other facilities in in Chino Valley?
This would apply only to the medical marijuana. If you want to limit conditional use permits in other areas, we would have to go back and revise those portions of the UDO.
Okay, I think that
yeah.
answered the question.
Any other questions for staff?
Thank you.
So at this time, I'm going to open the public hearing. We have a large number of people here this evening, so just a couple of house rules. Please direct your comments to the commission. Do not have conversations between yourself and people in the audience. Please address the commission. Please be respectful of other people when they're speaking. Don't call out, clap, carry on. We need to be able to hear what people are saying. And we have a lot of people here this evening, so we're going to limit comments to 3 minutes. If you'd like to speak, please step to the podium and state your name and address for the record, and then I'll start the timer. We have a little simple timer here. Is there anyone that would like to speak? Who's going to be the brave first one? All right, up here in front, sir. Thank you.
Hello, my name's Jim Runner, 330 South Mountain View. All I've got to say is this is my hometown, you guys. It's been this way for a long time, and I need to keep it this way, no matter what it takes. Because, you know, you think about driving down I-40, there's miles and miles and miles of stuff. They could grow all the pot they wanted. But, oh, that's right, you get into New Mexico and it's illegal there, so they gotta come here and do it in our backyard. I don't agree with it, folks, but I do respect your positions on it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Runner. Is there anyone else that would like to speak? Yes, ma'am, in the back.
Okay, my name's Peggy Trout, and I live here in Chino Valley. A couple of things I want to go over. This is a lawsuit that a person had, Coates versus Dish Network. Brandon Coates, an employee of Dish Network, was tested positive on the job after mandatory drug test that was performed on all the employees. Coates was fired because of this. Coates took it to court, lost, then took it to Supreme Court, where he lost his case. By the way, Coates was a quadriplegic and was a registered medical marijuana user, which state was this? This was in Colorado, where it was approved, I believe, in the year 2000. This is a state versus federal laws. There's a supremacy clause that states federal regulations prohibits the use of medical marijuana, but if a state regulation allows it, the federal law prevails over that regulation. And my question I just want to ask is, if the banks are federally funded, where is the money that's being made? Are the banks accepting this money that's being made off the medical marijuana? Where's this money going? Okay, so it doesn't matter if the state has passed and is allowing it. It's federal law, and federal law prevails. That's all.
Thank you, Ms. Trout. Is there anyone else that would like to speak? Yes, ma'am.
My name is Marilee Fowler. I have to admit, I actually live in Camp Verde, but I am the director of MAPForce. I hope some of you are familiar with MAPForce, but we're a substance abuse coalition, and we work really hard with people from all different sectors of the community to try to reduce substance abuse. I just have to say how sad I am listening to this conversation and listening to the PowerPoint about, you know, that this is state law. You know what, the medical marijuana was brought to Arizona by the Marijuana Policy Project. The initiative that was filed is 40-some pages, and the voters got this little two-sentence, you know, about, basically sold it on the idea that this was for cancer patients. We simply know that's not true. The number one age category of people who have medical marijuana cards are 18 to 30-year-olds. And I could tell you a lot of stories, but I just want to tell you from the perspective of somebody whose number one goal is to try to prevent kids from using substances, what medical marijuana has meant to Yavapai County. There's a survey that's done, it's called the Arizona Youth Survey, that's done by the Arizona Criminal Justice Commission. From 2006 to 2014 in Yavapai County, we've had a 20% increase of kids using marijuana. When we look at prevention science and why kids use a substance, there's certain things that we know. Number one, we know that when perception of risk of a substance goes down, use goes up, and that's exactly what's happening. On the Arizona Youth Survey, they asked the kids two questions. One, is it harmful to try marijuana? Over 70% of the kids that answered that survey, and it's a very large sample size from Yavapai County, said there is no harm in trying marijuana. When they were asked, is it harmful to use marijuana on a regular basis? Almost 50% of our kids said it is not harmful to use marijuana. That is because they've been told it's medicine. They see it legal places. The other thing we know in prevention science is that when the ease of access and availability is increased, use is increased. It was already mentioned in the PowerPoint. In the Arizona Youth Survey, 17% of our kids who use marijuana said that they got it from a medical marijuana card holder. Another thing we know in prevention science is when something becomes socially acceptable, use goes up. That's exactly what's happening. One of the things we do is try to provide education in our schools. It is so difficult to tell a child right now or a student that there's harms in marijuana. We know so many harms. It's not the same drug it used to be because of medical marijuana. They're making these strains that are 10 times as powerful as they were in the 1970s. I'm just sad that you guys are preventing. Okay, I'll wrap it up. But I just want to say one other thing that people don't realize. There's right now being signatures are being collected for legalization in Arizona. It will probably be on our ballot. It's from the same group that came here in here, the Marijuana Policy Project, thinking that we needed medical marijuana. Now they want legalized marijuana. And if it's passed, that dispensary will be a place selling legal marijuana, because that's what's written in the 20 pages. I just encourage people to really take a good hard look at what this is doing to our kids. It's heartbreaking. So thank you.
Thank you very much. Is there anyone else that would like to speak? Yes, sir.
Good evening. My name is Charles Shorkey. I live at 1709 South Robin Lane. And looking at the PowerPoint tonight, I see that this is all said and done. It started in 2010 for marijuana to be in Chino Valley. My complaint or issue is 4 South. Where's that water coming from? They got a well driller there now. And is that coming out of Little Chino? And Chino Valley is in the AMA. And each full-grown marijuana plant, according to Mary Jane's website, takes a gallon of water per plant per day. That's a lot of water. Anyway, also on the PowerPoint, I noticed there are property rights for private property rights. What about our rights? The expansion.
Please, none of that.
The expansion of this marijuana business, like I say, is said and done. We need to stop it where it's at. And the people who bought the property on 4 South, just like the people who over in San Diego in Point Loma, they move in and they complain about the airplane noise. The people who bought the property at 4 South had a certain amount of acreage, and now they want to expand it. We don't need to expand it, and that's my concern.
Thank you. Anyone else like to speak?
Hi, my name is David Albus, and I live over on 1236 El Valle Drive, Chino Valley. My little tidbit I want to give, it sounds a bit more humorous, but it's actually kind of sad when you start thinking about it. When I started hearing medical marijuana was coming to Chino Valley, I wanted to develop my own opinion. So I started kind of actively talking to friends, seeing where things go, you know. And one guy I was talking to, he's a marijuana user, and all he uses it recreationally. And anyways, I wanted to see just what has this done to this guy. And so when he was not high, when he was not at the current moment using it, I started telling him a story. I started telling him how my girlfriend, she's a mermaid entertainer. She puts on this costume and pretends to be a mermaid, that I was dating a real mermaid. And he believed it. He went on and was this marijuana has dumbed him down so much that this guy believed the mermaids existed and I was dating one. He wasn't high at the time. I mean, this is sad. This is sick. And another friend of mine talking to, and all he asked a buddy for a cigarette, and the guy rolls his own, hands him one. He hands him one from the wrong pile, and it has weed in it. This guy, who's a great guy, been fighting a custody battle with his kids, but he's trying to get his kids back, starts calling his ex-wife at 1 a.m. with all these stupid comments and things going on, you know, because he didn't mean to get high. He didn't intend to, but it's just so prevalent in our society, you know, that he thought he was smoking tobacco, and it was something else that he was given. And this is the real life kind of effects that it's having on day-to-day people here in Chino Valley, Arizona, right now. It may sound silly, but when you start thinking about where things are going with overseas and what we're going to have to deal with here at home, do we really want the young people around here to be that stupid? Do we really want them to be that dumbed down? We got a lot of problems in our society right now, and to have stupider people isn't going to help. We're trying to help people's intelligence by not having substance just freely given around, you know, where it is widely known to dumb people down. Anyways, you get my point, you know. So thank you.
Thank you. You in the back? Oh. Or ladies first. There we go. Thank you for being a gentleman.
Hi, my name is Michelle Alexander, and I may be in the minority in this room, but 12 generations of my family have called Arizona home. I understand our state needs. I also understand our small towns, and I would, like most people, like to see our small towns stay small. However, that being said, I got involved in the medical marijuana industry because of my youngest son who has a brain injury. He also has a brain disease. He has been on up to 17 prescription medications at a time, and the last 2 years he has been on nothing but medical marijuana. We have function in his life for the first time in 20 years. Besides that, getting me into the industry, after spending thousands of hours studying the laws and the rules for the medical marijuana program, I wrote a business plan for the medical marijuana dispensary, for the Chino dispensary. Now, there were 9 companies in the lottery. We were not selected. That led me into owning and operating MJ Consulting in Prescott Valley. I have been a volunteer in the medical marijuana program since 2011. I have assisted 1% of the 85,000 people in this state obtaining information, accurate information, legal information, and obtaining their medical marijuana card. Our oldest patient is 96. Our average patient is 65. I also write the only medical marijuana news column in the state. It's in the Yavapai Health and Wellness. It comes out each month. It's a question and answer column. It covers a variety of different questions that come in from people. So I would employ that you obtain one of those newspapers and read some of the articles so that you can get some true facts. Because the facts are, science says medical marijuana is a whole food, just like a blueberry, a banana, and a mango. It has 497 components, and the human body requires every single one of those components for homeostasis, which is mental and physical balance. We have seen lives changed in the 2 years since we opened our business in Prescott Valley.
Ma'am, can you wrap it up?
I believe that there's a comprehensive plan that could go in place in Chino Valley that would help limit, instead of limiting the business, you limit the industry as it comes into your town. I have typed that up, and I would be happy to distribute that to anyone that's interested, or I can mail it to the mayor, and he can take it from there. Thank you for your time.
Thank you for your comments.
Good evening, commissioners. My name is Rose Vasquez. I'm a Yavapai County community member. I live in Prescott, but my family's been living in this area for the last 10 years. My parents retired here. And I really want you to remember that you have a lot of power. I come from the field of prevention. I am from California. We're going through the same thing, but we were successful in placing moratoriums in several of cities. I come from Monterey County. You can look it up online. Monterey County Peninsula is a beautiful place to live, but now I live here. So you said to be factual, so I'll be factual. The Planning and Zoning Commission is slowing things down. I read the paper that somebody said in the Growers that they wanted you to slow down and make good decisions. You actually need to heed that. You need to slow down. You know, you have more power than you think you do because you have to look at built environment. Your commission is so important because not only do you have to look at zoning and planning, but built environment. You also have to look at environmental impact. What's going to happen 10 years from now? Environmentally, what is that going to look like in 20 years from now when you're no longer sitting in this position? So it's not just about zoning and your immediate fix. It's about the impact of the environment, and that means the people sitting out here. So one of the town's greatest assets is your next generation. And I looked at U.S. Census Bureau, and your largest population is under 18 years old. That should be the most detrimental population that you're actually thinking about. You need to consider that population because they're also your next constituents, your next local leaders, and they're the next ones you're going to be up here making these decisions. So you really have to look at how you're voting. If you don't protect these assets and your largest demographic population by approving and supporting growth of marijuana, you're sending a mixed message to the youth. I'm not going to talk about what marijuana does to you, and I understand, and I don't think anybody's over here saying don't give it to somebody who really needs it, but you also have a misplaced population who really think that it's okay. Placing restrictions to include community protective factors or a moratorium on future growth is not only smart, it's the right thing to do. It's the right thing to do to slow it down without a motion and to continue to gather data. You have already dispensaries. You already have growers. How many more do you need? If you want to really gather facts and do fact finding and you really want to do some really great anecdotal and some common evaluations, whether they're, you know, actual evaluations that you can actually determine, is there been an increase in crime? Have we had a cause and effect to this? Then you need to wait and take a pause effect because it takes 10 years to measure this kind of environmental impact. Millions of dollars have been distributed to local governments, but the cost of increased law enforcement, drug driving incidents, fatal crashes, loss of productivity, and a huge spike in crime should be considered and brought into question versus the cost benefit of those dollars. This is another slow down approach.
I need you to wrap it up.
Yes. Lastly, it is a fact that marijuana growers will create more jobs. As a matter of fact, the paper said that they were going to create more jobs. They are. They're going to create more jobs in the fields of drug treatment facilities, community interventionists, and law enforcement. So if you want to decide to move forward with future growth, I would suggest placing all your tax revenue towards the above-mentioned professions, because you're going to need them.
Would you like to come up, sir? Thank you.
My name is Perry Stone, and I live in Chino Valley, and I also work in the MMJ industry. I want to get back to kind of the facts that you were talking about. Since we've built our facility, we've had applications for employment by locals. We've spent tens of thousands of dollars a week on local labor that helped us build. We used all local rental facilities and spent tens of thousands of dollars a month here. We've created a business that is viable to this town. We also came here because the college is here and there's other growers here because of the climate.
Please don't speak while he's speaking. Thank you.
Okay, but we'd like you to know that the monies that are coming from this facilities are coming into your town. They're creating a lot of jobs. People are knocking on our doors asking for jobs because they don't have them. So, and we're trying to accommodate. And by changing, I don't think you should change many of the rules that you've already got in effect for the last years now. Because I don't believe that your town will be overrun by a criminal element. We're not seeing that anywhere else in the country. And the mayor.
Please.
We are so pleased.
We
are so pleased by the state with security. The police department here in this town is very attuned to what's going on, and they're watching out for us as well. Okay? Our tax dollars here are being spent correctly. They're doing their job.
Wrap it up.
So our recommendation to you is to slow it down if you need to get more facts. But we're creating a good income to this town. We're raising a lot of jobs, and we're not creating a security risk here at all.
Thank you, Mr. Stone. Would anyone else like to speak?
My name is Carla Acosta, and I live on 715 Judy Avenue. I am a wife and a mother of five children. We moved to Chino Valley 20 years ago out of the Prescott area. My children are the sixth generation born out of Prescott. I am deeply concerned with the future of my children. I am deeply concerned with what's going to happen. I agree, it's not just now we need to look at, we need to look at tomorrow. Because I'm bothered. I'm extremely bothered with what is taking place. And all I kept seeing on the board was, like it or not, just because Arizona says it's legal does not make it right. It isn't right. And I have several family in Colorado where it is legal. You can be wherever you want to be with this. There is extreme crime. There is extreme troubles. My nephew alone has just buried five friends in the last year, because the crime has gotten so out of hand. I'm concerned with my crew, folks.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to speak?
Hi, my name is Rebecca Robertson. I live in Chino Valley. And I guess I have a question. Where does this money go exactly? Does anyone know? I'm not sure. So do you guys, anyone know?
That's not what we're, that's not
well,
what this
that
commission
is. Well,
that
is my question, and I have a right to ask that question.
And you can put the question on the record, and if city staff can respond to that question, they will, since you stated your name and address for the record, they'll attempt to contact
okay,
you.
Okay, that would be great. I think, would you agree that that's an important question? I would hope. So, you know, I apologize. I don't know the rules here. But this is not cool, guys. We don't need this in our town. I'm not happy with it. There's many here who I understand there's medical issues. Marijuana is not a regulated dosage type of medication. We have morphine. We have other very strong medical drugs that are legal to a certain extent, but marijuana is not being treated the same as these other medical drugs. Why isn't marijuana going through a pharmacy? Why is it the separate thing out here? And we talk about finding ways to regulate and control this. I'm sorry, the facts kind of speak for themselves. This is out of control. It's spun out of control. And we're sitting here talking about ways to regulate marijuana. This is ridiculous. It's not regulated. And we need to wake up. And you guys do have a lot of power, and I respect that. And I'm asking that you would represent us, represent your citizens, represent the youth of this town, and do something. Please, I'm begging you, please. So I'm not an eloquent speaker, but I'm very passionate. Titanium is a natural thing, too, and so is arsenic. I heard a politician say that. Marijuana, there's a lot of natural things that grow in this world, but it doesn't mean it's good for you. So, you know, it doesn't matter. My dad said the other day, if you jump off of a skyscraper, yeah, it's great for circulation, but what's going to happen in the end? So we really need to use common sense here and think about what we're doing, you know. So let's join together and let's fight for the future, our generation, our high schoolers, our kids. I mean, what do we want this town to look like? A pot grower's town? Or a town known for its beautiful scenery and its history? We've got such great history here. And I don't think the ones who were here in Chino previously, the farmers, pictured it looking like this. This is not what they wanted. And you guys talk about in your meetings all the time, keeping this a small town feel, keeping that history alive. Okay. And this is not keeping that history alive. And I don't think the grandparents, I'm not from here, but I would say that the ones that have been here generation after generation didn't want their town to look like this. This was not what they viewed, and you guys know it. So I'm asking, please join us and please help us out. Please, we need your help. So, you know, forgive me if I'm out of place or I'm not a great speaker.
You did just fine.
But I'm passionate. Please, please help us. I'm begging.
Thank you.
I'm going to vote. I'm going to do what I can.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name's Heather, and I'm from Williamson Valley, Arizona. Lived in Chino Valley my entire life and gone all the way from kindergarten to senior year. So I've been here my whole life, pretty much. I'm also the dispensary manager. And I will tell you, you guys wanted facts and not opinions and not emotions. I'll tell you the facts of what I see every day. Our average patient is 51 to 60 years old. We have 2,000 patients. That's a big average. They're medicating for chronic illnesses on average. It's not young hoodlums coming into the shop looking to smoke. We're talking about regulated dosages, tinctures, things that are helping people going through chemotherapy, people who have MS, people who can't walk. I had someone complain about my patient parking sign saying young hoodlums going in there, taking up the pizza shop, smoking. Well, the truth of the matter is I have people getting out of wheelchairs and people that can barely walk. This medication is helping people. It's not hurting people. And the fact is if you guys regulate it so heavily in Chino and recreational does pass, you're creating a larger black market. You're creating people going into Prescott Valley, buying weed recreationally, and then bringing back to Chino and selling it. And at that point, you have no way of tracking how they got it. Right now, the patients that are operating illegally under the law and selling to other patients or giving it away freely, they can be tracked. They can be found. If we regulate it so hard that we can't track them, then it comes down to a needle in a haystack and trying to find them. If we don't embrace it, we're going to create a larger black market. I have 5 pages of signatures of people who support this in this town. 5 pages. And the truth of the matter is it can be dosed, it can be regulated. People take it to help with chronic pain and chronic illness, not to get high and not to ruin people's lives. These are your neighbors that you're talking about. You're taking jobs away and you're taking relief away from them. You want them to take morphine instead. Well, morphine kills your body. It absolutely destroys your liver, and you want them to go get that instead. The police have been great with us in town. We have a relationship with them. We're regulating it and trying to cut prices so that we can outbeat the street sales, so that there isn't a market anymore for street sales to happen.
I need you to wrap it up.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Hi there, my name is Jeff Tice. I live in Tempe. I'm a CPA. I also run the dispensary, not only in Tempe, but also one of the grow facilities here in Chino. You know, I guess I want to, just in general, I really appreciate just the, certainly the heartfelt comments and the, you know, emotion and perspective on a variety of people. Since I am a CPA, I'll tell you where the money doesn't go. It doesn't go to Mexico, all right? It doesn't go to Colombia. It doesn't go somewhere else. What it does is it hires people for us here locally, for people to have jobs, for us to provide a viable, benefit-rich environment to work in that is safe and comfortable and doesn't send money to Mexico. I'm a tax and regulate kind of guy. Which really means that we very, very strictly control what we do, how we do. I've been through over 10 audits. We've had zero findings, zero. We are the only guys in the state that have had zero findings. And that's because that's how we run our operation. And so the importance, I think the importance of this meeting is from a recommendation. I would strongly recommend that the commission do not forward all seven options. For possible action by town council, that we, as you say in your agenda, hold a public hearing on proposed amendments to the text so that we can sit down and evaluate and do something comfortably that, A, limits somewhat the unbridled growth, which is, you know, some of the issues here, and B, at the same time recognize that we certainly have a new industry that provides a wide variety of options and benefits for society and that really hasn't been explored in its full extent. And as we've also heard in our presentation, that it is legal here in Arizona and we have the opportunity here locally to be thought leaders. That's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Tice. Anyone else would like to speak? Yes.
Good evening, commissioners. My name is Travis Bard. I live here in Chino Valley. Would first like to ask your permission to address staff with one question regarding their earlier presentation, if I could.
You can address it to the commission, and if okay. We need the staff, we'll ask.
It was mentioned that, I believe it was Prop 207, There is a limitation there or a provision that for property owners who are harmed by a change in the zoning ordinance, the town likely has to compensate them. Is that correct?
That was presented in it, yes.
And how far back does that ownership go in the chain of ownership?
Perhaps the town attorney can answer that?
Yes. It's a change in a land use regulation after the property is owned by that person. So anybody who currently owns property And the change comes after they own it.
Okay. Yeah. So that then it would stand that if a property was next to a parcel that was rezoned with a new use and their property value diminished, the city or the town would then be responsible for?
No. It is only as to the property that is directly affected by the land use regulation. So if a property next to you is rezoned, you don't have a cause of action. The property owner does.
Okay? Okay. Okay, thank you. Two quick questions or points then on that. The zoning ordinance is full of restrictions, limitations of legal uses on properties. It's full of it. And I don't know that anybody would disagree with that, would you? That's what we're talking about here, is limiting use of legal uses. And that's what's being argued here, is that, hey, this is a legal use, so why limit it? Well, you limit somebody coming in and putting a feedlot in town. You limit somebody coming in and putting a strip club in town. Legal uses in the state of Arizona. Somebody can't come in and put a power plant in town. Legal use in the state of Arizona. So why then are we worried so much about the fact that this is a legal use and running from the fact that we limit the use of land for legal uses every day? That's what the zoning ordinance is designed to do. So in this case, there's been people from out of town who have flashed Prop 207 and said, you better not do it because we're going to come after you with this. I think that's something that happens every day. That's your job. That's why you sign up for what you do every day. Secondly, part of what has to be considered is perception, because perception can become reality. Those of you who have been watching what's happened in Prescott have dealt with this, with the rehabilitation home issue. I think we can all admit that that is a very viable, it's a use that is needed in our society. It's doing tremendous things for people in those homes. But it has painted Prescott into a corner with uses that have gone wild throughout the town. Would ask you to think about one thing. I sat with the rural director for the Arizona Commerce Authority and asked him what the perception is of Prescott with the potential relocating companies that come to Prescott throughout the world, throughout the Southwest. He said the number one perception is that it's a hotbed of rehabilitation centers and they won't be able to find the employees that they need for their job. So there is a legal use that's been allowed for quite some time. The barn door was open. There's a lot of people that wish it would have been closed a long time ago, and that town is suffering economically because of that. It's a black eye that they may not be able to do anything about in the future. You have an opportunity now to limit a legal use. We're not saying that those people who are running clinics here, who have growing facilities here, have to leave. We're just looking forward and saying, okay, what might we need to do to limit this for wise growth down the road? Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi. Margaret Overton, 3420 North Cottontail Drive. Unlike most of these folks, I'm new to town. I researched before I came here. We moved from New York for medical and financial reasons, and I was concerned about the high teenage pregnancy in the high school, called and talked to teachers in Prescott and Chino, and found out that actually you guys had turned that around a lot with education and a lot of hard work, and decided to send my son to Chino, where he's enjoying the Chino Valley Marching Band, and we're gaining a reputation for being a great little town with a good band. Pretty proud of that. It's why I'm late tonight. But I'm concerned that if I were looking today, I did a search today, I would see that there's medical marijuana here. I don't know that I would have moved here with a 16-year-old. I was real proud that in Carmel, New York, the little town that we were in, we like little towns, there was very little usage because there wasn't a distribution channel, and it wasn't near a big town, and there wasn't a lot of use. So I'm concerned about what's happening here. And reading the article in the review, I was sort of struck by the fact that it came to the public's attention. Years after it's been done, it came to the public's attention, and there's a public outcry, and let's slow down now. It's like, why wasn't the research done before you ever, you know, invite growers and do this? Why would it come to public attention at the last minute? And why wouldn't that be given due consideration, the feeling of people that live here, that grow, that have their children here? So I think we should be known for cougar pride, not cannabis pride.
Thank you. Anyone else like to speak?
I'm Kate O'Connor Massey. I live in Chino Valley, and I am affiliated with the industry. Thank you for your time. You may recall from the last appearance I made here that I spoke a lot about science, clinical studies, the FDA, and the relationship between those things and medical marijuana. Most of the crowd that's here tonight did not hear my remarks, and if anyone would be interested in furthering that discussion, I'm happy to have it, and I brought proof sources with me. However, I'm not going to repeat all of that for you now. What I proposed last time is what I would propose to you again. I don't agree with recommending all options to council. I think that a study session or two or more made up of interested parties needs to occur, and I highly recommend that you proceed with that. I literally have heard so much misinformation and all outright falsehoods tonight, and I'm not trying to be accusatory, but I'm trying to say there is so much misinformation here that your job is made exponentially harder, and I'm sorry for that. I would like to be part of the solution by explaining the research that my husband and I have done for years because we agreed to be a part of this industry. If anything, I would recommend that the town figure out a way to do economic development to attract more cannabis here and not less. And I will show.
Please, it's her turn to speak.
Pardon me.
Please address the commission.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. I would encourage the town to look very, very carefully at what is going on in cannabis. And as most of the people here tonight were not here last night, they don't realize what's happening with FDA and the National Institute for Drug Abuse and so on. To help you, staff members, I brought you copies of the July 2015 drug facts from the National Institute on Drug Abuse. There's a copy here for each of you. Likewise, from The Lancet, which is a worldwide leading medical journal, in their subsection of psychiatry, I brought you medical marijuana laws and adolescent marijuana use in the USA from 91 through 2014, results from annual repeated cross-sectional surveys. I would encourage you to read them. This one's a little dense, so I brought one, and you can read the cliff notes. This one is easy to read, and it's from the director of NIDA, who's never been a big fan. But you'll see a fair and balanced bit of information in this, and I encourage you to take a look. Lastly, I would encourage you, again, not to forward these recommendations until a study session has been made. Then, if the recommendations still make sense, you may want to proceed down that path. I don't think there's a need to rush this. I really don't. I think we can come to a thoughtful conclusion together with no emotion, with facts and evidence, and I'd be happy to lend my support to that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Commissioners. My name is Chad Nanke. I live at 2300 West Gray Fox Circle, Chino Valley, Arizona. I'm glad tonight that we're not talking about science, pro or con to this, about medical marijuana tonight, Commissioners. With a topic this divisive, we need to do what's best for Chino Valley as a whole. I want to bring up three bullet points. Number one is Proposition 207 that was brought up last meeting. I talked to Ivan Legler, town attorney for Prescott Valley. It was his opinion that implementing stricter zoning ordinances regarding growing marijuana would not diminish property values. We're talking about stricter laws for one item, growing marijuana. We're not talking about taking individuals' property's rights away for an entire zoning use classification. Furthermore, how would an appraiser hired to show diminished vacant land values be able to do that when vacant land values are in fact trending up right now? How could that be proved? What about the property values of us? It's been mentioned, Chino Valley citizens. who will reimburse us for our property values being diminished by my next point, stigmas? And for stigmas, just so we all are clear, what does that mean? A mark of disgrace or infamy, a stain or reproach as on one's reputation. With all the news this issue is generating, Chino Valley is already getting a black eye due to this issue. Commissioners, we do not want Chino Valley to be stigmatized due to our community becoming known as a little town full of pot farms. This type of stigma, I believe, will have what would be future citizens look to move elsewhere. And I've had many, many, many calls since this has started, and it's just, you can already see a stigma starting. Chino Valley has experienced enough of that through the years already. Let's stem the tide. Let's stop it now. When is critical mass as far as marijuana pot farms? We have four on its way. When is critical mass when we have a stigma in this town that can't be turned around? Is it three farms? Maybe already four? Is it six? Is it 10? When is it enough? I think right now, we're already hit critical mass, in my opinion. Employment. We heard last meeting from a pot farmer how wonderful this federally illegal industry is for our town. Do we really want pot farms to be one of the larger employers in our town? What about other industries and businesses that Chino needs to attract to the area? When potential employers perform due diligence and demographic studies, what does it say about the employment pool in the Chino Valley area when pot farming is the shining example of the fastest growing industry in our town?
I need you to wrap it up.
Many citizens would rather have slow business growth in Chino Valley that every citizen in our community can be proud of rather than this type of employment growth that is so divisive to so many Chino Valley citizens. One last thing. Myself and many fellow Valley citizens urge the commission to recommend to the mayor and town council changes that only reflect what Prescott Valley and Prescott already have in place. We're not asking for the town to do anything illegal. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes, sir, in the back.
My name is John Trout, and I live in Chino Valley. I've been here before. I'm sure you're all familiar with me by now. I picked up a few things since the last time I was here. One of them is medical marijuana overview, and I'm sure everybody's probably picked one up and looked at it. And this is from a bunch of lawyers that are trying to make money off people doing this. But the update here that I have on mine is there's generally a tug of war between the federal laws and state laws concerning medical marijuana. On the one hand, the federal government makes it a crime to cultivate, possess, or use marijuana for any purpose. On the other hand, some states allow the use of marijuana for medical reasons. Generally, in cases where federal law and state law collide, federal law prevails. And users of state-authorized medical marijuana may still be arrested and or prosecuted. The U.S. government shifted its attention to larger drug trafficking issues when the Obama administration took over in 2009 because he had them back off, basically. With the Department of Justice stating it would not prioritize the environment in the enforcement of federal marijuana laws on authorized users of medical marijuana or their caregivers. However, the Department of Justice resumed its prosecution of medical marijuana providers in 2011 and put pressure on publishers who run ads for medical marijuana dispensaries. So you can't advertise it, you know, this is what we sell. That's just one. Another one is, I don't know, when I asked before people had read the law, and it's, I guess I left it, no, here it is. it's Proposition 203, it's 16 pages, you know, and so for people to vote on something, it's full of 16 pages worth of all kinds of information, good and bad. When they got to vote on it, they had a paragraph, you know, that this is what it's about and for and against. And so, you know, nobody, even I had trouble reading all 16 pages. And I'm sure whoever, I think it was you that said that you read it, so you probably had trouble too. And also just one other thing, I did look up Proposition 207 and I did talk to some attorneys. I wasn't quite as good at it as he was, but come up with the conclusion that, yeah, if they really want to get to it and you want to expand and do all this thing and my property value goes down, you're going to get some lawsuits. That's the way it is. That's just thanks to that. Okay.
I need you to wrap it up, Mr. Trout.
Pardon?
I need you to wrap it up. Up here in the front.
Oh.
Up here, yeah.
You want me? Anyway, I have one other thing that's really kind of interesting, because I'm really down on marijuana anyway. I don't care what anybody says. I know personally for a fact, and I even wrote some papers on it and everything back when I was in law enforcement, but marijuana leads to all other drugs. And, you know, everybody that uses all other kinds of drugs, if you talk to them long enough, they started with marijuana. That's just the way it is. And they get it any way they can. And these people that grow it, I got a kick out of this this article in the paper where the one grower says that, you know, he wants to really expand and don't...
Mr. Trout,
you know,
I need you to wrap it up, Mr. Trout.
What?
Up here in the front.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
anyway.
Your 3 minutes are up. Yeah, I need you to wrap it up, okay?
All right, that, and just one other thing, and I'll be done.
Okay.
Here's a United Medical Marijuana Clinic. You can get on the internet, you can give them $150, and then go meet their doctor, and it takes about 20 minutes, and then depending on the patient's need, that we can get you a American medical marijuana. Right there.
Thank you, Mr. Right Trout.
Okay. Sure.
My name's David Ryan, Chino Valley. I've had a medical marijuana card for a year, just renewed it for the second year. I don't get much help from the VA for my medical problems, and I don't want to get too much into it, but I have Gulf War syndrome from Desert Storm. It's an immune deficiency, a nerve deficiency, bone deficiency, muscle deficiency kind of problem that's way ahead in the medical field. There's no cure. There's no treatment. And they don't want to give me any medication. They basically want to just push me under the carpet. So I did my research about medical marijuana, got my card, and that's what I'm using right now. As experimental. I'd like to promote the medical marijuana. I understand you guys might need to downsize the grow of marijuana, but I think for a lot of people, it's the only thing that we have. There's a lot of research and development going on with the medical marijuana. There's a lot of terpenes that make up the marijuana. And I don't want to talk over my head because I don't know too much about it. But each terpene can be used for different medical problems. I have so many different medical problems, the doctors don't even know where to turn. Too many pills clog up my kidneys and my liver, which I already have chronic organ pain anyway, so I need to eliminate taking any kind of pills. So I would like to say financially it should help the community. I understand people don't want their kids getting into it and they want to keep their community small. I understand all that, but I just ask for the people of the community and the commission here to understand the benefits from medical marijuana and that soon we might all be on it.
Thank you.
I don't think, I'm Sally Bates. I live on Road 2 South. I have about 17 family members that live here in Chino Valley.
grandkids went to school here, graduated. I am deeply concerned. Nobody's questioning the legality of what's happening here. What I'm perceiving is happening is we are doing a miniature environmental impact survey. And I think that the government requires a lot of agencies to conduct an environmental impact survey. And I think what you people are hearing tonight has nothing to do with the legalities, the morality. We are, we who live here, live in an environment that we have sought and kept for many, many years. I have five generations in this county. The environmental impact survey that is happening in this room tonight is, I think, what should be taken into consideration more than anything. We're not questioning legalities. We're not asking you to do something or undo something that's already been done. But the environmental impact that this is having on the majority of people in this community is very important to most of us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bruce Robertson, Chino Valley, 2184 East Cyrus Lane. And I just want to encourage you guys to dig deep on this, to do your research. What I've heard tonight is that if you're against it, you're just being emotional. If you're for it, then you have stats. If 2,000 people in our town have cancer, then I think we need to be checking our town's water more than anything. I mean, you know, I think we really need to fact find and check the numbers on this. What this basically boils down to is our town, the future of our town, future businesses that could be looking at coming into this town versus a handful of people that stand to make a lot of money if this is passed. So are we here for the handful of people looking to make a lot of money, or are we here for the town? I think you're here for the town.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to speak? You can go next.
Hi, my name is Rudy. I own the dispensary in Chino Valley, and we operate a 26,000 square foot cultivation facility in Prescott Valley. So I would venture to invite all the council members to actually come to the cultivation facility and see what's going on a daily basis and talk to the two cancer patients that work there that are surviving because of cannabis usage. Yeah, excuse me. If giving patients access to the medication they need on a daily basis is a crime, then I'm a criminal, honestly. So I'd rather have every patient be able to come into the shop on a regular basis and me be on the line for it, rather than have to do a backdoor deal or go to some parking lot or be uncomfortable and acquire meds they have no idea what they're getting. We are vertically integrated. We produce everything that goes into that shop, and we care what we give our patients. So if anybody has any questions or needs detailed information and wants to see a functioning facility, we are more than welcome to come visit. Thank you.
Thank you. And I'd just like to say for clarification that we are not the city council.
Sorry.
We're the Planning Zoning Commission, and we're going to make a recommendation tonight.
I misspoke.
To the council. But just so others, if anyone else in the audience misunderstands, we're a recommending body only. Is there anyone else that would like to speak? Yes, sir.
My name is Paul Conant. I was here before in your previous meeting. I'm a lawyer, and I represent one of the landowners and a cultivator. So we're on 1 East, and he's the fellow in the aforementioned news article. He's in the front row, sitting here with me in the jeans. Last time when I was here, I wanted to bring something to you to try to help in the process. One of the comments that I made was that we understand what a difficult job you have. We understand that the town council has said to you, we want you to make recommendations to us. And we've listened, and I've taken notes at the last meeting, I've taken notes today very carefully about what everyone has said. These comments that we're hearing from the last meeting and the comments that we're hearing today, both pro and con, are some of the best that I've heard. They're at least as good as any of the comments like this and other meetings that I've heard in other contexts. So you're getting a full airing of these issues. I invited the town council, or the, I'm sorry, the commission, Planning and Zoning Commission members to come to my client's facility last time when I was here, and I handed out my business cards, and no one took us up on that, and that's okay. You don't have to do that. We did invite the press in, Mr. Sane from the Prescott Valley Review. He may be here tonight. He came with his editor and a photographer, and if you've seen the article or articles in the paper, you can see some of the photographs of what it looks like on the inside of one of these facilities, or at least on the inside of my client's facility. I know that you're planning on having a vote tonight, so I know there's no time to go visit, but I didn't come empty-handed. I did bring something else with me tonight. That is my colleague, Mr. Pugh, also an attorney, but he's a very talented land use attorney, 35, 36, 37 years. He can tell us years of experience, and there are a couple things that when it's his turn to speak, he's going to mention a couple of things that we'd like the commission to consider that may potentially help you and may potentially help you to help the town council as well. I'm going to be over here with my client, Mr. Abrams. If anybody has any questions for us after the meeting, including members of the audience or the commission, we'll sit around for a while, and if people do have questions for us, we'll be here to respond to those questions. Thank you.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, members of the Commission, thank you for the opportunity to be here this evening. My name is Ralph Pugh. I live in the town of Gilbert. I work in the city of Mesa. I'm here this evening on behalf of Mr. Al Abrams as a consultant concerning land use. That's really what you're dealing with tonight, commissioners. You're commissioners for land use issues. In front of you tonight is an ordinance that's been drafted that is proposed to be forwarded to the town council for its deliberation and vote. That ordinance restricts, in many respects, the cultivation and dispensing of medical marijuana in the town of Chino Valley. You also have an existing ordinance today. That ordinance allows the cultivation of medical marijuana in certain zoning districts as a permitted use. The proposed ordinance changes some of that. And the question, I think, for you and ultimately the council is whether or not, indeed, by adopting the change in the ordinance, will you thereby potentially diminish the value of the property of those who are currently operating and expect to expand their facilities. I would suggest to you, as you consider a difficult decision, to consider two possible alternatives in addition to the recommendations you've heard from your staff. Number one, you can recommend to the council, and the council could, if they wanted to, adopt a development agreement with Mr. Abrams that would outline the extent to which he could expand his facility and how big and under what conditions and what sizes, what access, a typical site plan approval for future expansion, and codify that through a development agreement that would assure the town that there would be no Proposition 207 claim against the town, and it would assure Mr. Abrams that he could proceed forward with his reasonable expectations of the use of the land. The second possibility, commissioners, for you and the council to consider that I would recommend to you is under state law, there is what's known as a development protected rights plan. This is a new concept that's been enabled for towns and municipalities to adopt. You could consider a site plan from Mr. Abrams on his property. It's the old, we call it the KOA property. You could consider a site plan that shows his expansion plans. And if you adopted that site plan as a permitted use, you could adopt it also as a protected rights plan, and he would then have the right for a number of years to develop that, regardless of how you may choose to change the ordinance for the future. Thank you, commissioners, for listening tonight. You've got a tough task. We urge your recommendation to council of at least considering those two possibilities to avoid the 207 claim and protect the private property rights of those that are here operating legitimate businesses today. Thank you very much.
And then you in the front.
Good evening. Hi, my name is Jason Heaton. I live in Chino Valley. I just wanted to speak with you all real quick. I've listened to a lot of good things tonight, democracy at work being one of them. Appreciate everyone's viewpoints, but a little background. I fought in Iraq in 2006. I was on cleanup, and I got rocked pretty good. I've got a traumatic brain injury, small vessel disease, back problems, you name it. I've been through the ringer. The VA loves to prescribe medication, which most of you know is a going, you know, trade, if you will. Cannabis offers a more organic alternative. I will not take pills from the VA. I do not like it. I do not like feeling drugged. I do not like waking up in the morning and, you know, not being able to find my own feet. With the marijuana issue that we have at hand here being zoning, you know, I do agree, give them a corner, let them build a fence, and let them have at it. You know, it's bringing revenue into the town. There's no problem with it. But as far as marijuana's culpability, as far as pharmaceutical and monetary gain, you've got substantial gain here. I mean, like I said, if there's issues with morals and where you want the property set, go ahead and outline that, work through it. But do not deny us the chance to get the medication we need. As of right now, I do not have a medical marijuana card. I sleep little less than, let's see, 4 hours a night. I won't get a card because of this bias, this prejudice, and this moral dilemma that we have. It's not fair. If something works medically for a group of us, if kids get their hands on it, I consider that, you know, more kind of a parenting issue, if you will. Like one person mentioned, okay, well, mommy and daddy take medicine. Okay, well, why does mommy and daddy take medicine? Because daddy got blown up in Iraq. There's a viable alternative to blaming other people for something that is medically relevant. So I appreciate your time. Thanks for letting me speak.
Thank you. And thank you for your service.
Councilwoman and commissioner members, my name is Todd League. I'm a small business owner in town, and there is a lot of emotion in this, but the facts are is that we're looking at changing zoning. As a small business, we are all limited in things. I can only have so many people in my business at a time. You know, you can only do certain things. There's limitations on everything. And right now, the way the state regulations are, there is no limitations really on what can be grown and how much. And all we're asking here is that you would make the recommendation to limit. If I go to the town and say, I want to expand my house, they're going to say, you can only go to this amount, 40% of your property. Can you cover with a roof? There's limitations in all life. So I'm just asking that you would go ahead and make these recommendations. We're not putting anybody out of business. We're not running them out of town. We're limiting them just like we limit everything else in life. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Last chance. Anyone else that would like to speak? Oh, you've already spoken, ma'am. Anyone else that would like to speak? There you go. No do-overs, sorry.
Sorry, I may have gotten here late tonight. My name is Sean Woodsum. I live over in off of, nervous as hell. Anyway, I live in Chino Valley.
That's good enough.
Gold Rush Way. I was astounded. I think, what was the proposed square footage on the road for south? 120,000 square feet?
I don't know. That's not a question before this commission tonight. Sir, you need to address your questions to the commission?
Well, just what I'm saying. I mean, what I'm saying is it seems like everybody's claiming that there's a shortage of marijuana around here. And it seems like there's plenty growing. And I don't understand why expansion is the problem here, and us limiting it to a certain size right now is, I think, is doable. I think, I mean, 3,000 square feet, that's a lot of plants. And the proposed, what I've heard is the proposed is 120,000 square feet on road four. It's what I've heard, right? That's the size of a Home Depot, in case anybody wants to know that. I'm trying to raise a family here and just trying to raise two children. All of my life I've been told that marijuana is wrong. Marijuana, you shouldn't be smoking, people that smoke it are bad. I understand the medical part of it. I do. I'm not against that at all. What I'm against is it being on our front porch, coming in on the roundabout, being there on the right-hand side. All we want, if you're going to grow it, be discreet. Let's just put it somewhere. If you can grow it all you want, way out on Perkinsville or something. But let's take it off the front porch at least.
Thank you very much. Anyone else?
Good evening. My name is Carolyn Erickson, and thank you for your service to our community. I understand and I can hear both sides, but why Chino Valley? And I think tonight when you make your decisions, I hope that you really consider what the vision of this community is. What's the vision? What do we want to stand for? I mean, who are we as a community, as a group of people? Why is it that we have people from who do not live in this community, who don't have our values, coming here and bringing a business that so many of us are uncomfortable with, that do not meet our values, do not meet our vision? And if you give an inch, I think you know the rest of that line. But I hope that your concern is for the reputation, for the lifestyle, for the vision, for the values of this community, and that your decision is not based on anything else tonight. What do you want your community to stand for? And when you leave these positions, what is your legacy? What is going to be your legacy tonight? I'm not trying to put anyone to shame, but I think this whole decision is about the vision of this community called Chino Valley. Thank you.
Anyone else? Are you sure? Because once I close the public hearing, there's no more. Okay.
At 8 o'clock, we need to change that.
Yeah. We'll probably have to take a break.
My name is Ed Albus. I just came from work, so sorry for my dress code.
What was your name again?
Ed Albus, A-L-B-U-S.
Thank you.
And I live here in Chino Valley. I also operate a small business. I understand what it means to grow a business and want to grow your business. I love agriculture. I grew a lot of produce to give away to people here in Chino. And I helped meet a lot of needs. But as a pastor also, I see what comes into my church, and I see young people that I have to deal with that have bad parents in their home, that have grown up with the drugs, not just marijuana. But it started with marijuana. And everyone that I talked to, it started cigarettes, then marijuana, they went from there. I understand a medical use. My wife has to take some drugs that I hate. I hate them with a passion. And she's not taking marijuana. Don't worry about that. But I understand what oxycodone does to a person. I understand what morphine does to a person. I just about lost her because of those drugs. But the biggest issue for me is when I see a young person who can't make a decision in their life because of things they have done in their younger years. And it started with marijuana. It's been a passion of mine to work with these kids. I don't turn them away. I love them unconditionally, but I still have to look at them straight in the face and tell them what's right and what's wrong. I encourage you to look into our town at what's right and what's wrong, and make a moral decision, an ethical decision for our community, for our young people, I know our teachers, some of them, are burdened by what they see in our kids. Are you burdened for our children? Because our children are who's going to sit in your seat later, whether high or sober, who knows? Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, my name's Pat Bates. I live at 3935 West Road 2 South. I think that, you know, there's been a lot of talk about marijuana and whether it's right or not, and that's not really the issue here tonight. I think that there are ample growing facilities in for marijuana in Chino Valley now. And I see kind of a move almost like prospective growers are moving in here because the laws allow it, where they do not in other places. And I therefore think it's prudent to forward to the council all seven recommendations to limit this until we can see what it's going to do to our community before it's too late. I think that's prudent. It doesn't have to stay that way forever if the facts 10 years down the road don't bear it out. But I think that's the thing to do now. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Andy Erickson. I live on Promin Lane in Chino Valley. And I brought 33 friends and coworkers with me tonight who have signed the petition to stop and limit the growing of medical marijuana in Chino Valley. And I just ask you all tonight to do what you can to limit this so it doesn't get out of control. But I just would like to say that. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
My name is Lee Shaw. I live on 2420 North Parama Lane. I'll be brief. I want to reiterate, what do we want our town to look like? What do we want to be known for? What is our town image going to be down the road? As for the guys that, the soldiers here, my heart goes out to them. But there's an argument that just seems to be ignored and poofed, and that is, and let's regulate it like everything else. Why is it treated separate? It's already been said here tonight. That's the biggest thing for me. And I could just stand here and ditto on a number of these different issues, concerns that we have, you know, as a father, as a pastor, representing at least several hundred people in this area that are saying, we don't want our town to look like this. We don't want to be known for this. They're already totally surprised and frustrated that at our front and back door, our south entrance and our north entrance, what is the first thing that you see? Nobody's hiding anymore. We are already becoming known as Pot Town. We don't want that. I don't care about the right or wrongs or all of them all. And how come is it that those of us that feel this way are poofed because we're being emotional, again, as somebody else said, but then the others are considered smart and educated and they have all these facts. We have facts as well. And these facts stand. Look at Colorado. Look at what's going on. Look at Fox News. The night that the Ohio was up, they were having a big vote on Fox News. And they were having a big vote in Ohio. And John Kasich came out and stood against it. He provided leadership. He based it on real facts. Fox News themselves acknowledged the states that have passed these things have had a sharp increase in children's visits to the ER room. Traffic violations and accidents have had a sharp increase. This was their facts that they laid out quickly before they cut away. I don't want Chino to look like that. I love this place. When I look out across it from where my home is at and see this beautiful valley, it is already in my mind a dark place. That why did this have to happen? Why does this have to potentially be our future? I beg you, I urge you, move forward with this action, and let's at least slow it down until we can see what this is really about. Take a look at Colorado. I think that'll give you a good clue. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else that would like to speak? Once we close the public hearing, there'll be no more public comment tonight. Anyone else here like to speak? Okay, seeing none, I'm going to close the public hearing. We've been sitting here for an hour and 45 minutes, so I think maybe a short break is in order. But I will tell the audience that the commission is sitting in a quorum right now, and even on the break, it's inappropriate to discuss this subject with any members of the commission during the break. Okay? So 10-minute break, and...
It sounds like the same type of advice that Ann Landers always gives. She also, she's not living.
No, she's not. She was a human athlete, but you know, kind of died almost because of genetics. Don't get me wrong. I guess it hasn't happened for Abby. Don't we have any, you know, we can ask people here to do that? And the planning director just sent a memo to council saying we're going to treat it like a drugstore and we don't need an amendment to the codes. And we dropped the 500-foot barrier and sent it to council to show that with the schools and the churches, we don't have any other lawyers. Is that like Chino Valley? So we basically just like a shutdown issue. But here with our agricultural zoning and everything else.
It's a unique place. It's not like it.
I just wonder why they're trying to locate here. I don't know.
So are we ready to start again?
Yeah, we are.
Is everybody ready to start again?
She's
already ready.
Dr. Coffee.
Yes. Okay. We'll give Ruth a minute. The only difference is they don't vote at study sessions, they just discuss items. There's no action items at a study. It's a good time to air issues and discuss issues so that when they do come to a voting session, they can make an informed decision. According to Ruth's
thing here scheduled for Denver.
There's another presentation.
She's going to go over that after the break. We're going to let Ruth explain that one more time after the break here, so we all understand it. Yes. No, you should read it from the agenda item, or from this here on the screen. One of the two.
Doesn't it sound like a January meeting is going to continue?
We're going to talk about that here in just a minute, as soon as we're done with the break.
I'm cold. It's chilly. They decided to keep the air conditioning.
Did you see that? I had that plane at home. I could have the air, but
I wonder how many people will stay for the discussion and vote. That's what I'm curious to see. A lot of people want to say their piece, but they want to stay and hear it out.
Yes. Nice to meet you.
Well, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. All right. I try. It's hard with so many people.
I just don't know that because, you know, when you're writing, so I hope you wasn't trying to take it.
You did great, Mike. All right, we're going to call this meeting back to order. I think it would be helpful for me and perhaps for some other members of the commission if the staff could go back over the recommendations, since we didn't actually receive that in writing. That would be helpful.
There you go. There. Okay. So the proposed options, and I want to be clear that these are all individual options. The recommendation to Town Council is not to adopt all of these, but the recommendation is to provide these options, these choices to Town Council, for them to decide which ones they want to select or reject them all and start all over. First would be to allow cultivation facilities on-site only, which means that any new ones would have to be attached to a dispensary. Remove cultivation and infusion facilities from conditional uses in AR 36, AR 5, and AR 4 zoning districts. Remove cultivation and infusion and dispensary facilities for permitted uses in CL, which is commercial light, commercial heavy, and industrial zoning districts, and require a conditional use permit in those zoning districts instead. 3A, again, is require a conditional use permit for any medical marijuana facility in industrial zoning districts only, which would mean that cultivation facilities and dispensaries would be allowed only in industrial zoning districts. Option B is a conditional use permit for any medical marijuana facility in commercial heavy and industrial zoning districts only. And option C would be to require a conditional use permit for any medical marijuana facility in commercial light, commercial heavy, and industrial districts only. Again, that would mean that they would have to get that anybody that wanted to open a new cultivation facility would have to come to the Planning and Zoning Commission, hold public meetings, hold a neighborhood meeting, post their property, mail letters, everything that would have to be done if they were asking for a rezoning.
Excuse me, could I ask a question?
Sure.
Does that include if they were operating under a use permit and they wish to expand the use permit, they would also have to come in front of the commission?
Are you talking about anybody that's operating under a conditional use permit as of right now?
Well, there is no one operating under
right.
a use permit
I was going to say
right
there
now.
Is no
correct?
One operating under conditional
right.
use
but
permit
But if they
right
were
now.
To pass that option
and someone came in with a use permit and then they wanted to expand the facility, they would have to come back and get a new use permit?
I think at that point, we would be looking at a site plan. One of the items that the two options that Mr. Pugh brought forward, I think, are very worthy of consideration just to deal with just that issue. Require 500-foot separation from churches in addition to already specified uses. Measure separation from property line to property line. Exclude public right-of-way from measurement of the separation. Limit size of cultivation facilities to 3,000 square feet or another specific size limit. And that would be all of them. Unless, you, as I said, I would suggest adding the two options brought forward by Mr. Pugh for the development agreement and the protective development rights plan. Is that what it was?
Yes. Development protected rights plan.
Development protected rights. Excuse me, I got it backwards.
Or a DA for expansion. So I don't know if this question is for you, Ruth, or for legal counsel, but we cannot ban medical marijuana growing facilities in Chino. Is that correct?
That's correct.
So because the UDO regulates land uses, we can specify what zoning districts this use would be permitted or permitted with a use permit. Is that correct?
Correct, and we've already done that.
It's currently allowed in the AR-36, AR-5, AR-4.
With conditional use permits, right. And then commercial heavy, commercial light, and industrial is a use by right.
So it's allowed in commercial heavy and industrial by right?
Mm-hmm.
But is it allowed in commercial light?
Yes, because the majority of commercial light is within close proximity to residential.
Okay. So my other question has to do with if the state regulation or even the town's regulation does not allow it within 500 feet of a residential use, is
mm-hmm.
that correct? Because the AR districts allow residences,
mm-hmm.
then a facility could not be located within 500 feet of a home?
Correct.
So that's already in place?
An existing residential use, correct.
Okay. So it's not residential zoning, it's a residential use.
If it's in an AR zoning district, it's a residential use. If it's commercial heavy, commercial light, or industrial, it's zoning district.
Okay.
So it may be helpful if I went back through the regulations we already have in place.
That would be helpful.
Okay, when the council adopted Ordinance 13-779, we amended portions of Chapter 2, which is definitions, Section 2.1, meanings of words and terms. Greenhouse commercial, a commercial greenhouse, is a commercial enterprise that grows plants or parts of plants by the application of water to plants that reside within movable containers, raised beds, or lined beds that are disconnected from the land and are not deemed to be irrigated lands as set forth in Arizona Revised Statutes. Medical marijuana, all parts of the genus cannabis, whether growing or not, in the seed of such plants that may be administered and used by a registered qualifying patient, as that term is defined in ARS 36-2801, solely to treat or alleviate the patient's debilitating medical condition or symptoms associated with the patient's debilitating medical condition. Medical marijuana cultivation, the process by which a person or persons grow a medical plant, a marijuana plant for use as medical marijuana. Medical marijuana cultivation facility offsite, a building, structure, or other enclosed locked facility used for the cultivation or storage of medical marijuana that is physically separate and not located on the same real property as a medical marijuana dispensary with which it was affiliated pursuant to ARS 36-2806, subsection E. Medical marijuana cultivation facility on-site, a medical marijuana facility that is located on the same property as the medical marijuana dispensary with which it is affiliated pursuant to ARS 36-2806, subsection E, whether attached or not. Medical marijuana dispensary, a not-for-profit facility that, pursuant to ARS 36-2801, subsection 11, is registered with and certified by the Arizona Department of Health Services to acquire, possess, cultivate, manufacture, infuse, deliver, transfer, transport, supply, sell, or dispense medical marijuana to qualifying patients and card holders, as that term is defined in ARS 362801. Medical marijuana facilities, medical marijuana dispensaries, medical marijuana cultivation facilities on or off-site, and medical marijuana infusion facilities. Medical marijuana infusion facility is a facility that incorporates medical marijuana by the means of cooking, blending, infusing, or otherwise combining medical marijuana into consumable, ingestible, or edible goods. In terms of the actual zoning districts in AR 36, like I said, as a conditional use, 3.5.3 conditional use permit required, subsection O, medical marijuana cultivation facilities with or without infusion facilities subject to the regulations set forth in section 4.31. I should note that we currently have no real estate, no property in the town currently zoned AR 36. AR 5, the same, subsection 3.6.3, conditional uses, conditional permit required, medical marijuana cultivation facilities with or without infusion facilities subject to the regulations set forth in section 4.31. 3.7, AR4, agricultural residential, subsection 3.7.30, medical marijuana cultivation facilities with or without infusion facilities subject to the regulations set forth in section 4.31. Commercial light, AE, medical marijuana dispensary subject to the regulations set forth in section 4.31. AF, medical marijuana offsite cultivation infusion facility subject to the regulations set forth in 4.31. Section 3.16, commercial heavy, subsection P, medical marijuana dispensary subject to the regulations set forth in section 4.31. Subsection Q, medical marijuana off-site cultivation and infusion facilities subject to the regulations set forth in section 4.31. Section 3.17, industrial, 3.17.2, subsection I, medical marijuana dispensary subject to the regulations set forth in section 4.31. Subsection J, medical marijuana off-site cultivation and infusion facilities subject to the regulations set forth in section 4.31. Section 4.31. Medical marijuana dispensaries, off-site cultivation facility sites, and infusion facilities. A. All medical marijuana facilities shall comply with the regulations set forth in this section. B. All medical marijuana cultivation facilities shall be wholly contained with an enclosed locked facility as defined in ARS 362801-6. Prior to the issuance of subsection C. Prior to the issuance of a certificate of occupancy, a medical marijuana facility shall provide written evidence of the following from the appropriate state regulatory agency. One, the proposed facility is in compliance with all applicable state regulatory agency and state law requirements. Two, any application submitted to and approval granted by a state regulatory agency. Three, in addition to the documents required in subsection C1 and C2 above, an applicant for an infusion facility, whether located within a dispensary or cultivation facility, shall provide certified copies of all approved permits and licenses required by the local health department. Four, in addition to the documents required in subsection C1 and C2 above, an applicant for a dispensary shall provide, subsection A, a complete list of the cultivation infusion facilities from which the dispensary will receive medical marijuana or medical marijuana infused products. Said list shall include the name and physical location of the cultivation infusion facility, two, the number of any state license granted by the state regulating agency to the cultivation and infusion facility. Three, the name and contact information for each and every member of the board of directors of the cultivation and or infusion facility. B, a copy of the operating procedures submitted to and approved by the state regulatory agency. Five, in addition to the documents required in subsection C1 and 2 above, an applicant for a cultivation facility shall provide a complete list of all dispensaries for which the cultivation facility will cultivate medical marijuana, including A, or one, the name and physical location of the dispensary, two, the number of any license granted by the regulatory agency, and three, the name and contact information for each and every member of the board of directors of the dispensary. Subsection D, the following separation requirement shall apply to all dispensary facilities: 500 feet from any school, public or private, 500 feet from any public park, public building, or public community center, 500 feet from any drug or alcohol rehabilitation facility or correctional transitional housing, 500 feet from any residential zoning district, except that for cultivation and or infusion facilities in an AR, agricultural residential zoning district, the separation shall be 500 feet from any existing residential use. E, there shall be no retail sales, restaurant, food service, or entertainment activities within a medical marijuana cultivation facility. F, dust, fumes, odors, or vapors emitting from any cultivation or infusion facility shall be mitigated to minimize impact on surrounding properties. Mitigation includes, but is not limited to, the following: ventilation of buildings, dust control, and or installation of and use of devices designed to minimize dust, fumes, odors, or vapors. G, all medical marijuana facilities shall be located in a permanent building or structure. No such facility shall be allowed to locate in a trailer, cargo container, or motorized vehicle. H, the total square footage of a medical marijuana dispensary facility shall not exceed 2,000 square feet. I, there shall be no consumption of medical marijuana on the premises of any medical marijuana facility. J, entry into limited access areas within a medical marijuana facility is restricted to medical marijuana dispensary agents or persons accompanied by a medical marijuana dispensary agent. K, medical marijuana infusion facilities shall, one, be located on the same site as a dispensary or a cultivation facility. Two, on-site infusion facilities, whether attached or freestanding, shall not occupy greater than 20% of the gross floor area of the respective dispensary or cultivation facility. Three, there shall be no retail sales, restaurant, food service, or entertainment activities within a medical marijuana infusion facility. L, all cultivation of medical marijuana shall take place within an enclosed lock structure comprised of a roof and walls that fully obscure all plants and cultivation activities from public view and in compliance with the provisions of this code and Arizona state law. There shall be no outdoor cultivation of medical marijuana within the corporate boundaries of the town. So those are the existing regulations already in place.
Thank you. Does anyone else have questions for the staff?
I have one question. The developer for the property on 4 South, mm-hmm. do they already have a conditional use permit or
no.
do they have a building permit already?
They have not yet been issued a building permit. They have not applied for one, but they have applied for and had plans approved for their drainage and grading.
Okay. And do you know if they have been approved as a medical marijuana facility by the state of Arizona?
I don't know if that one has been approved yet or not.
Okay,
but
thank you.
I can't stop them from doing grading.
Okay, thank you.
Can I ask legal counsel to sort of give the commission an overview on the limits of what our purview is on this item on the agenda tonight?
Yes. Madam Chair, members of the commission, having heard the comments and wanting to clarify your role, you are making a decision as to land use recommendation to the council. You can't do anything about access by the youth to the medical marijuana. What you are talking about is cultivation facilities and where those should go, what limits should be placed on them from a land use perspective. And you are also not talking about any particular application for a medical marijuana facility at this point in time. You are talking about regulations that will apply citywide or townwide. Does that help?
Thank you. So also for clarification, any facilities that already exist will be considered legal non-conforming use.
Correct.
If we change the code.
Mm-hmm.
And do we know how many facilities already exist?
Depends on what your definition of exist is. We have three that are currently cultivating. We have two that we have one that is currently doing earthwork. We have one that has already, we've spoken to several times about submitting plans that has had approval in the past, and then we have another property I expect to get plans for tomorrow.
Thank you. Who'd like to start?
I have some questions on the proposed options.
I'm sorry?
I have a couple of questions on the proposed options.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, you read what was in place already, and there's a 500-foot separation. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. There's a 500-foot separation. And I noticed that some of these proposed options are saying, okay, we're not going to count right-of-way, and there's other items that aren't going to be counted for the distance. And that one of them was to include churches. And I'm just wondering why those options are coming up.
Well, we've had a number of discussions about this, and there were commissioners that have asked that we include the churches. We've had the public ask that we've include churches in that separation for the 500 feet. Mm-hmm. There were suggestions by commissioners that we, when measuring the 500-foot separation, exclude the public right-of-ways that would require, so that the separation distance would be effectively be increased by that distance of the right-of-way.
I realize, and that's why I'm raising that question.
Right.
Because when you give notice as to if you're going to be doing some zoning hearings, you know, you say 300 feet, and you count the right-of-way with that 300 feet.
Right.
So why is this different, other than someone asked for it?
Because this is what the direction from town council was to bring forward a whole group of recommendations in terms of text amendments for the UDO. And this was one of the suggestions that was made.
This is the first time I've ever seen where they say exclude the right-of-way.
We talked about that at the meeting on the 17th. Mm-hmm.
No.
Yeah.
Okay. Let me clarify then. This is the first time since I've been working with planning and development and transportation, which is over 20 years, that anything has said, let's exclude the right-of-way. Whenever you've done development, it's always been including right-of-way. But I won't argue the point.
Any other questions?
Yeah. Has the staff done anything in to evaluate the possible financial impact of a 207 settlement or suit? In other words, do we have any idea of what the financial impact may be to the city if we exclude further development of the people already at this?
Significant. Significant. These grow facilities already grow in excess of $2 million worth of product a year.
So it could potentially be a large loss.
Yes.
Thank you. Will that resolve?
Wait. I need Phyllis to clarify about how the 207 works, because we have to establish a value. Go ahead, Phyllis.
Well, let me explain a few things about Prop 207. If a property owner believes that their property value has been diminished, they can bring a claim within 3 years of the effective date of the land use change. If they bring a claim, the town has 90 days to respond, and the town has some options as to the way they can respond. One of them is to change the land use regulation. Another is to agree with the complainant as to a value or a settlement amount. And another is to approve a waiver of the application of that land use regulation to that particular property. If they do that, that waiver would run with the land and be applicable to all future owners of that property. But it's not like, oh my God, we've got a claim, we're going to go down the tubes because the town's going to be bankrupt because they're going to have this huge settlement. It's not the kind of a thing where they immediately go to court and it becomes a horrible problem. The town will have options, is what I'm trying to say. So, and as Ruth was saying, there is some question as to what is the diminished value of the property. Is the property actually diminished, which I think one of the audience members spoke of, speaking with Ivan Legler, who said, well, you know, it may not be a problem because they have to, somebody has to show that their value is actually diminished. They're going to have to get appraisers. There could be a battle of the experts. You don't know what's going to happen once you get into court. Yes, there is a potential exposure. should that cripple the town? Probably not. You know, Ralph Pugh gave some options where maybe we could agree with his client ahead of time that if the town does impose these new regulations, then we would have these agreements that we could do with his client, and perhaps his client would then not bring a Prop 207 claim. Maybe some of the other existing owners would be interested in doing the same kind of thing. We don't know what's going to happen, but like many of the audience said, you as the commission need to do an assessment as to what you believe is the best option for the town or best options to approve to pass on to the council for them to consider. But don't be scared by Prop 207. There are things that can be done so that you don't have to worry about it.
I have a question for the town attorney. The diminished value is only to the property itself, not to the loss of business or revenue to the business through the business itself?
That might be difficult to separate. I don't know. I don't think there's been a whole lot of case law developed on that issue. But I think that when you're valuing property, you know, there are different ways of value it. And if there's an existing business on the property and that business is not allowed to operate any longer, then yes, probably the loss of revenue from that business would be considered in the property factor.
Well, we're not really not allowing it to operate. We're just not allowing it to expand. Am I correct? Would that be?
Well, yes, for some of the options. For others of the options, where you have a permitted use now, I believe that you're considering a couple of the options would consider. One would be to allow it only with a conditional use permit, and another would be to not allow it at all. So an existing property owner may claim that his property is property value is diminished because he can't do what he had planned to do on that property.
Well, that seems kind of nebulous to me. Any person that owns a piece of property in town could say that they were losing money because of this thing that we passed here tonight. There seems got to be a way to limit who can come to the town and say their property values have been diminished. In other words, if somebody owns a piece of property now and has no thought at all of operating a marijuana facility and then we pass this zoning, can he come and say, oh my gosh, you guys just stole my value away from my property, whether he ever had an idea to do it or not? Is that possible?
Anything's possible.
Likely.
I mean, is it likely? I doubt it. I mean, I don't think so, because, you know, it would take some expense on their part to do that.
And there is a process that has to prove
yes.
out, and their value has to be determined, and they actually have to prove that they had some forethought. So there is some safety valves. In
yes. There. Yes, there are. There are. Just another thing we have to thank the voters for.
I have a question follow-up. In my understanding, and I just need clarification, if someone does bring a Prop 207 claim before the town has the burden of proof. Is that correct?
The town has the burden of proof as to the diminution of value?
Correct.
No, I don't know that. I don't know. I think that it is the other way around.
Okay.
I think that it is the property owner who would have to show the diminution in value, but I'm not certain on that.
I have a question. Doesn't Prop 207 also address a change of ownership for the property?
Well, it has to be a change in the zoning regulation while the property owner owns that property. So the concept being that when you buy a piece of property, you are deemed to know what is permitted on that property. So you buy a piece of property and you look into it for the purpose that you wanted to buy a property. And you look at the regulations in the town and you say, yes, I can do what I want to do on this property. And then in the meantime, the town comes in and changes the regulations and they can't do what they were planning on doing or had already started doing, whatever. So that's why it only affects the owner of property at the time the regulation is approved.
There you go. Yes.
Or becomes effective.
Yes.
One more question. The gentleman brought up some different ideas to bring to bring up about how to control the effect of the proposition. Are these ideas, can they be presented to the city council if we don't label them tonight? In other words, it would be my intent tonight to send everything we can to the city council so that they can review it. But if that doesn't happen to be in there, can somebody bring that up in the next couple of public meetings that we're going to have as a viable option to add to the ordinances?
I don't think it really belongs in the ordinance. I think it's something that the town always has an option of doing. But we'll think about that. I mean, this is new to me tonight, too, and maybe there is a way to put it into the ordinance.
So if we didn't put it in there tonight, we're not harming ourselves.
No, you can recommend that it be presented to council as a possible option for the ordinance as well.
That would mean that you'd have to explain it to me so I could write it down to put it in the motion.
Well, maybe we'll let Mr. Pugh do that.
Because it seemed like those ideas, at least they're options that can be reviewed. I wouldn't want to handcuff the city council by not including something that could be of a benefit, personally.
That would just about preclude any type of Prop 207 action by that property owner if a development agreement or what he calls a development protection right plan could be approved by council.
Let me just clarify this. There is a protected development right plan provision in Arizona state law. So this is an option whether you put it in officially to your ordinance or not.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'd like to make a motion, Madam Chairman. That we approve ordinance, do we have a recommendation on a screen here? Proposed, I'd like to go with the recommendation that to forward all seven options, including 3A, B, and C for consideration and possible action by town council regarding ordinance number 15-806.
I'll second that motion.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion?
I would like discussion. I am concerned about Prop 207 with even with the safety nets in place. I would like to talk about including the development agreement and the development protective right plan as a recommendation for the council to take a look at to include in the amendments. And I'm also still not I'm not opposed to the study group also of the equal parts advocates and opponents and staff advisory to see what the possible financial loss could be, but also what the benefit to the town could be and socially and economically. I'm not okay with sending this forward without without 100% information and due diligence. I understand that staff did has worked on this for a really long time. I think we need to look at the two options that were set forth tonight. I think they're very viable, but I have not read them, so I don't know. I would like to make a recommendation that that goes to council. And I'm still in favor of a study group, so I'd like to make that recommendation to council also.
Madam Chairman.
I understand I might be alone on that one.
I'd like to comment on that. I think the Development Protection Rights Plan, and as Joyce said, and development agreement can be included in this, however we word it, that they do consider this. However, I do think that time is of the essence. I think we have, you know, we could study this and study this and study this. And I just don't think, I think with a month notice now, that some interaction should have been already taken by staff, and the marijuana community to already begin discussions on this, rather than wait until city council establishes a study group or planning commission establishes a study group. I think I have enough information on hand tonight to move forward with a motion for approval, and those are my comments.
I think Mr. Smith had a comment.
Yes, Mr. Smith.
Sorry to interrupt the deliberations. I just wanted to inform the commission that last week council determined that they were agendizing a work study session for the purposes of engaging the public and having a dialogue with the public on the 10th. Of this month. So they will have an official meeting on the 8th, and then they will have a work study session on the 10th. And I think Jamie's already putting together the agenda and getting the notices out. So that will be on the slate that week.
So there will be three more meetings on this, or two?
Two, at least.
Yeah, well, at least two, and then the vote session in January, is that my understanding?
The item is not on the council's agenda for the 8th. That's their official meeting. They have a working agenda already that's been published for that, but they will have a work study on the 10th. They do not have any other meetings in December, and their first meeting will be in January, and it's anticipated that it will be on their agenda then.
Okay. So December 10th and January the 12th will be additional discussion on this
Correct.
Item. Okay. Did you have something, Claude?
Yes. Just a couple of things I would like to get on the record. I do believe that this needs to be forwarded to the City Council for action. However, I have a statement I have to make. I think this is moral legislation, and I'm thoroughly opposed to the city and the government getting into regulating morals. That said, I would like very much to see a, in all deference to our city attorney, I would like to see some more formal approach to a constitutional lawyer or a land use lawyer and getting an opinion about the actions of 207. I've talked to several attorneys during the last week. My business, I deal with attorneys all the time, and I have access to a lot of them. And there is a divided opinion on whether or not the 207 action would be limited to those who are presently in the business. You mentioned the possibility of a person simply having adjacent land who has never used, never thought of putting marijuana growing onto his property, but nevertheless, if it is banned now, there is a potential for a land diminution or value diminution on that property that might be subject to it. Also, I've been advised that the limited amount of case law that is on 207 so far, it has almost always ended up with the city or whoever is being claimed again, to prove it's a negative proof. The city has to prove that it isn't a claim. I don't have to prove it at all. I can simply make that statement, and it seems the way the claims have worked in the past. None of them have perhaps a very large economic impact, so whether or not they've ever been tested, I can't tell. But I am concerned about it, and I do think that we need to research it to some more detail, or the City Council needs to do that. I will support the forwarding of the recommendations, but still with my, I don't like to see more legislation.
I understand that. I'm looking at the time of is of the essence, and that this goes back 5 years. Am I correct, Ruth, when this was originally approved, 2010?
2010, the voters approved.
So we're looking at property owners since that time, changed ownership, whatever. We've also
That's when the voters approved the medical marijuana.
Okay.
The town did not regulate this until 2013.
So we're looking since 2013, any property owners affected since 2013. And the city also has the opportunity to waive. So in other words, we're limiting very drastically any financial impact to the city by this waiver. And so what we're doing right now is putting regulations in place to meet the needs of the community as expressed by the community. As for those who say we should wait and study this further, I think the community comes first. I think studies, if this drags on to March or February, people have the opportunity to come in and buy additional property to do what they want for the cultivation of marijuana in our community. So I look upon this as an emergency measure. We can always change the code down in the future to make it less restrictive. I believe that's what you said Tempe did. They're increasing the cultivation to 30,000 square feet or dispensary.
I think that was Mr. Tice.
Okay, so in the future, if we see that, the community sees that as a need and it's viable, we can always change the code and make it less restrictive.
Sorry, I lost my train of thought there for a second. During the last meeting, we went, as you recall, line by line through Prop 207 and discussed the fact that there were waivers available, that there are options that the town does have, and that there are the diminution of value is still a concern, that we not put the town in, we need to avoid putting the town in a position where that's even a possibility, in my opinion, in my professional opinion. We need to be very careful on how we go forward with this. I think that the recommendations that we have, coupled with the options that Mr. Pugh has brought forward, put us in pretty good stead.
Any other comments?
That is my biggest concern, because it's not just us. It is, like a lot of the members of the community said, it is for the younger generations also. We're recommending this to go to council, and they elected them, we elected them. I have faith in them. But I am concerned about the financial impact that this could have on the town. We don't need any more debt on the town. So that is my biggest concern. I need that to be on the record in regards to Prop 207. I like the idea of adding the two different agreements that were mentioned earlier. And I have to say on the record again, I do, I would prefer to see a risk-benefit analysis of rezoning.
So Mike, would you consider amending your motion to add two additional options for the council, including a potential development agreement or development protected rights plan?
Absolutely.
I would still second. I would just like to say on the record too that I think medical marijuana is a complex issue. Obviously, there were people here tonight, everyone driven by a different motivation or background, if you will. You know, the military men especially touched me. And so I think we need to find some middle ground. We may not find common ground, but we need to find some middle ground. And I
while, you know, a study group might be a nice, you know, if we had the time, I kind of have to agree with Mike and some others that, you know, the UDO is a fluid document. It is always changing. It's not, once we adopt this, it will never change. If we find that the circumstances are different, you know, we can continue to study it even after we make this recommendation and council adopts something. We can continue to study it. And I think education about this subject is going to be our biggest friend as we move forward. I think there's a lot of education that needs to happen about it. But for tonight, I am in agreement with the motion on the floor. I think we need to give our town council as many options as possible to consider. And they certainly have a lot of them to consider. But, you know, with all the ones that are on the floor, those, you know, seven is a big number, and we just added two more to the mix. I think the council needs to consider, when they consider which option they're choosing, is who will it impact the most. You know, industrial zoning tends to be off the highway, away from schools, away from people, for the most part. I mean, obviously, it's there were a few parcels that you pointed out that are near homes. However, because they're within the 500-foot buffer, that excludes them from the use. You know, when you get into the commercial districts or the commercial heavies, even with a use permit, they're still near the churches and the schools and the other things like that. So, you know, initially I've thought about this a lot. I've talked to a lot of people. I've prayed about it. It's not an easy decision. So, you know, I would encourage the council to choose the right option that's the least impactful to the community. And I do believe that is the I zoning, if that's the direction that they're going to go. So, is there any more comment from the commission? Anyone else like to speak, or should I call the question?
Question.
Okay, then I'll call the question. All those in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed? Seeing none, the motion passes unanimously. Thank you. There are no non-public hearing items, no discussion items. Public comment is for any item not on the agenda this evening. Is there anyone that wishes to speak on any item not on the agenda? Thank you. Chair will entertain a motion to adjourn.
Make a motion.
Second.
A motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.